All right, we are back, and this is still Crossfire with Dapo and Ishioma. And we've been talking about the state of security in Nigeria vis-a-vis the newly selected service chiefs that will be working with the Buhari administration. I mean, Nelson has been saying very frantically that the outgoing service chiefs are all compromised.
I understand that, yes.
But do you know, while we're celebrating, you know, the new appointment of new service chiefs, some people are lamenting, actually. Because you know, there's been mixed, you know, reactions. Some are saying that the president was too hasty in sacking the old ones and appointing new ones, that he should have continued working with them.
No, but the truth is that the delay before now is
to our democracy and this fight against.
And for me, I think it's for a proper handover. No,
even take note of, there's this African adage that says, "What a young man standing on a tree will not see. An old man sitting down can see better." You see, when president, what you are saying is that the wisdom of the old man, you cannot put it, is not sold on the shelf. Mm-hmm. When President Muhammadu Buhari came on board, honestly, a lot of Nigerians expected immediate dismissal of these services. Mm-hmm. But the man realized that, look, this is my own institution. Mm-hmm. I must not come in with the spirit of vendetta or vindictiveness. True. Because we are all living witness to the rules that these service chiefs played to ensure that elections
not
never
even
took
the
place.
More pronounced role by the National Security Advisor.
The chief of army staff, Major General, Lieutenant General Kenneth Minima, the role he played in Ekiti to assault democracy, working with all those characters, are in the open.
Do you know Minima contributed to the lingering matter in Ekiti state till May the 29th, when their responsibility
but
and all that.
Do you see the Senate confirming this appointment soonest?
Well, they don't have a choice, except if they are enemies of the Nigerian people. They don't have a choice.
Now let's take a look at the, you know, at the pedigree of some of these guys. I try to look into, just to take a background check on some of them, and I discovered that all of them actually have a very, very deep insight into logistics. Mm. What does this?
Well, it shows to you, because you know military is about logistics, It's about planning, it's about strategy. Moving people and materials, knowing when to strike and when not to. Mm. So it shows to you that you have a commander in chief who knows his onions.
Almost all of them. Yes. In fact, all of them have one training or one responsibility or the other across the armed forces.
Without logistics, nothing can be done, because it is through logistics that you achieve the goal of an organization by making sure the right materials are available at the right time.
The right personnel deployed to do the right thing
at the proper time.
So operation becomes so smooth
very, very optimistic that very soon we'll end this Boko Haram menace that is bedeviling
Nigeria. I have, yesterday we talked about this, and we just quickly pinpointed out some of the areas the insurgency can be dealt with as quickly as possible, while not overlooking the other areas. I also think one of the necessary strategies which these new service chiefs they need to look at is, for me, is fast-tracking the trial of some of the previously arrested Boko Haram suspects. Because every now and then we hear of jail breaks, we hear of these people arrested in large groves, but yet they still find their way back into society. They leave with some informations and with that vengeance, and they go back and they strike harder. So for me, I hope that these new service chiefs will, they will fast-track their trial.
No, you see.
Do you think that's possible?
The issue.
Ordinarily,
the trial of the Boko Haram suspects is not the duty of the service chiefs. It's the duty of the Nigerian government.
Very true. And the judiciary.
Yes.
But they can petition.
The judiciary will only act based on your available facts. Don't forget that in law, for you to get a conviction, the court must be convinced beyond reasonable doubt.
Yes.
You cannot bring somebody to the court and say, no, you must present your facts. Mm-hmm. So it is not left for the government to ensure that the general insecurity that has developed to a situation whereby even our prisons have become grounds that criminals can just come in at will and ransack the place.
And in fact, even most times also plan.
Yes. So it's a reflection of the total breakdown of security in the country. And I'm sure with this new government that we know the track records of the head of this government in President Muhammadu Buhari as a disciplined man, as a focused man, as a tested military tactician.
Okay.
We know that our security is going to improve. Not minding the fact that some people will try to, you know, try
sabotage
is part of human life. A Jesus had a Judas among his 12 disciples. So the issue is not whether there will be sabotage or not. It is part of human. But the issue is that the government, I'm sure, is focused on breasting the tape, no matter the sabotage.
All right. We cannot talk about security enough. You know, we can only just, you know, try as much as possible on the show to continue to have to say it until we see the end, you know, of insurgency in our country. We want to use this this platform at the same time to wish all the newly appointed service chiefs, you know, the best of luck as we build,
our
you know, as we
look
forward,
sincerely, as we look forward.
Now let's quickly look at another very important topic. I was privileged to your write-up yesterday, and I realized that there's been, an unprecedented looting of the Nigerian treasury, you know, by some parties, especially, you know, public office holders. And some of these, things are not mere allegations. They are beginning to find footings because there are indications that these crimes were actually, you know, committed.
Yeah.
Now, how very bad do you think the Nigerian treasury has been looted?
It's as bad as anybody can ever imagine. Mm. Don't forget, as early as 2013, the former CBN governor and now governor and now Emir of Kano, His Eminence, Sanusi Lamide Sanusi, came on air and alleged that $20 billion oil sales funds were unremitted by the NNPC. Before then,
this was in 2013.
Before then, in 2012, when the government then of President Goodluck Jonathan increased the price of fuel, we all took to the streets. And the outcome of our street protest was that the National Assembly set up an investigative panel, which discovered that the subsidy regime was being used to scam the people. But till the government left office, it couldn't get anybody prosecuted. It even got so bad that one of the alleged oil subsidy thieves, a top aide of former President Goodluck Jonathan, went to court to stand surety for the alleged subsidy thief. So even as at 2013, former President Olusegun Obasanjo, in his letter to President Goodluck Jonathan, titled "Before It Is Too Late," alleged missing oil funds. In the same 2013,
and that was the time he talked about NNPC not remitting
their money. In the same 2013, the House of Representatives set up a committee to probe the unremitted billions of dollars by NNPC. In 2015,
that was what led to the 20
billion that the government tried to, you know, sweep under the carpet.
Yeah.
Instituted a panel, a PricewaterhouseCoopers to investigate, to do a forensic audit. And when the forensic audit was done, the government kept it under the table. When election was approaching, the government quickly said they should release the report. Mm. When the report came out and quickly were questioning the report, the report said about $18.4 billion. The government now, the auditing firm themselves even came out and said their reports were based on what was available to them, that in most instances, they didn't get the documentary evidences from the relevant agencies. In 2015, former CBN governor, Chukwuma Soludo, came on here and accused Mrs. Okonjo-Iweala that 30 trillion naira was missing under her watch. In 2015, the National Economic Council, from their report, said NNPC sold about 8.1 trillion naira worth of fuel in 3 years, that they were only able to remit 4.3 trillion to the Federation account, that they have 3.8 trillion naira unaccounted for.
Sorry,
let's quickly take this call. Good morning, Mohammed.
Hello, good morning, Dapo.
How are you doing today, Mohammed?
Yeah, good morning, Ishioma.
All right, good to have you on the show.
Yeah, good morning. So, I want to say this is the right step in the right direction.
Thank you.
Yes, Mr. President has done what we've long been expected from him. So I just want to say this is beginning and end of the insurgency in Nigeria and
Amen.
The corruption, impunity, and so on we have in the mm-hmm. military and the other forces. Mm-hmm. Because what I want to say is the other service chief, the sacked service chief,
should be
don't have anything to offer to Nigerians, to be sincere. Mm-hmm. They've long been overdue to be sacked. So I want to say this is the right step in the right direction.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so very much for your contribution, Mohammed. All right.
And in June, the National Economic Council alleged that Mrs. Okonjo-Iweala withdrew $2.1 billion from the excess crude account.
And he denied.
She denied. She said the money was shared at the Federal Accounts Allocation Committee. And the Federal Accounts Allocation Committee came out. And
FAC said, we did not approve any such money for you.
The next minute, she changed her music and said it was President Goodluck Jonathan that instructed that, which was against the rules. Don't forget, one of the reasons why former governor of Rivers State, Rotimi Amaechi, had a running battle with the president, was the issue of...
All right, let's quickly take this call. Before we continue, Nelson. Bala, good morning. How is Makodi today?
Good morning.
Good morning.
Hello, Bala.
Yeah, hello, good morning.
You're welcome, Mr. Bala.
Crossfire.
Thank you.
All right, let's take your contribution quickly.
Okay, my name is Bala Abakar. I'm calling from Makodi.
I'm calling in
respect to the new appointed service chief by Mr. President. Mm-hmm. I would want to advise the new service chief to speak. I would want their body language to speak even more than their voice. Mm-hmm. We want action in their body language so that the military, because our military plan has been so diminished. They've been so bad. If you go to our federal highways, you see what they do. Yeah. It's what it's about. So I would want the new service chief to speak. I would want their body language to be very sound, to speak so that the Nigerians will know that, yes, we have seen new service chiefs. And then so that even the Boko Haram will know that, yes, that have really taken a new dimension to
offer
the suggestions we have in experience in the country.
Thank you so very much, Bala.
Thank you so much.
Nice contribution coming from Bala.
I think we should also let Bala realize that the new service chiefs are aware of the huge expectations from Nigerians. And
it's not only Nigerians.
Even the international community. And also, they've gotten the marching orders from the commander-in-chief. Mm-hmm. And when the commander-in-chief gives an order in the military,
don't look back.
So, and I'm very sure they will respect his military antecedents. I'm very sure they will respect that. Okay.
So, she was alleged to have unilaterally withdrew $2.1 billion. Yes. And you see her making double speak. Don't also forget that just not too recent, the Minister for Finance and oil marketers were involved in a verbal warfare about how much the government was owing the marketers. It shows to you.
That was the classical example of the 202 billion as against 131 billion. It simply means, and we discussed it on the show, that does that mean the government does not, or Okonjo-Iweala, Mrs. Okonjo-Iweala, I mean, with respect, does not even have a credit, a balance sheet.
It shows
credit
that,
and debit. This is how much we are owing, this is how much we are paid, this is how much we have that as balance. Let's take this call before we continue. Abdul Karim, good morning.
Good morning.
How is Kano today?
Thank God it's fine.
All right. Thanks for calling the show. Let's take your contribution quickly.
All right. Please, there's a way to advise them. I wish they bring back the military checkpoints.
Okay.
I believe very strongly that if it's a strategy that is going to work for them or work with what they are bringing to the table, then I think
we should let the callers realize that the order that Mr. President gave checkpoints should be taken off, mm-hmm. but that it is not the role of the military to maintain internal checkpoints.
Mm-hmm. Yes,
that is the duty of the police.
Yes, that is the police work.
That is the police work. So we must learn to allow our different institutions to work in tandem with the constitution.
All right, let's take this call. Roland, good morning. Hello, Roland.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good to have you on Crossfire.
Okay, good morning, gentlemen and lady.
Thank you very much.
Okay. I really appreciate the interesting topic this morning.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah. The issue of the service chiefs that were appointed, I think basically borders on the issue of security.
Mm. Yes.
Especially the issue of this insurgency or terrorism.
Correct.
In the Northeast.
Yeah.
I think we have to approach this thing holistically. Mm-hmm. Boko Haram can never be crushed by military might. Even if I appoint Colin Powell as Nigeria's defense chief, mm-hmm. we can never crush Boko Haram. Like the current Khan president said, that this is an ideological warfare.
Yeah.
We have young men that voluntarily leave their houses and join these sects and take an oath to die fighting this cause. Mm. And we have parents who will volunteer their daughters, their kids, as suicide bombers to this sect. So it goes beyond military approach. Mm. We have to get involved. The religious leaders, these are the imams, the alphas up north, to get these guys to understand the true perception of their religion. Mm-hmm. I believe we can employ a better approach. I don't think we can handle Boko Haram through military approach alone. Good morning.
Thank you so much, Roland.
Fantastic. Could this have informed the choice? I mean, you know, we said it earlier. If Roland actually listened to us, that this possibly mm-hmm. could have informed, you know, the choice of this gentleman.
Definitely, like Roland rightly said, security is about intelligence. And all you have stated, the approach to combating this Boko Haram should be multifaceted.
All right, let's quickly take this call from Oshogbo. Sam, good morning.
Can you please call us back? Thank you.
All right, so let's just take it from where we started.
Yeah, so you see that the management of the economy under the former finance minister and coordinating minister for the economy was very, very untidy. A lot of allegations were rife in the air. And for a sitting governor, to allege that you withdrew 1 billion. If she's a woman
that
has integrity, I would expect her
to come up with papers
it's not even a loan. She should sue Governor Dapo Banjo and Ishioma for defamation of character.
If his allegation is
if she believes that she says the truth. Okay. Because don't forget, in 2015, January, when Chukwuma Soludo alleged that 30 trillion naira was missing under her care. Soludo even challenged her to a public debate. She said, I don't have time for you. I won't join issues with you.
All right,
this
Nelson.
Is an admittance.
All right, Nelson, well stated. Let's go on the short break. When we come back, we'll still be talking about this same issue. We'll be right back. All right, we are back, and this is still Crossfire with Dapo and Ishioma. We have Nelson with us in the studio. He's a political analyst, and we have been talking about how badly looted the Nigerian Treasury has been. Do you think we have any chances of recovering?
Definitely.
Monies that have been looted by public office holders
in
Nigeria.
Yes, I believe there is chance for recovery because of the fact that we have a government that is committed, that has come out publicly to state our commitments to transparency and accountability. That is why that's why President Muhammadu Buhari directed that all federal government revenues must be paid into a single federation account.
And so many other accounts shut.
There are too many accounts being operated. The NNPC under the former finance minister was operating just like governor of Kaduna State, Malama El-Rufai. He was expressing his frustration that a situation whereby an agency of government can withhold 42% of the nation's earnings. Abba, it shows to you that there's a parallel government.
All right, let's quickly take Sam's call. Sam, good morning.
Yeah, good morning.
Hello, good morning, Sam. Welcome back.
Hello, morning.
All right, we can welcome hear you. Back. Welcome back.
Yes, sir.
All right, let's have your thoughts.
Welcome for the good job you are doing there.
Thank you very much.
I want to be a little bit against what Mr. Lessing is saying.
Okay.
And he's talking about the election in Osun State and Ekiti State. If you look at the election that was being done or being conducted during the federal and the state. Can you get one answer?
Yes, we can.
We are listening to you.
Just the one being just concluded, the national election. Is that one being also rigged?
Okay.
So now compare it with what he's saying. So it's what the people of those states, of that APTC, that's what won then.
Okay.
So it's not that maybe it was being rigged. Just hear from those people from those states, you hear what they will be saying. So not comparing what you, the journalists, are saying. So wherever the APTC, wherever they lose, that's what they will be complaining about.
Oh, okay.
All right, thank you, Mr. Sam.
That's just what I want to say.
All right, thank you so very much.
Mr. Sam got it all wrong. We're not talking about rigging. What we are talking is the abuse of military personnel.
The military personnel that they played.
That a military man on duty is not supposed to put on hood to cover your face. A military man.
What are you hiding?
Is not supposed to be a marksman. He's not fighting a guerrilla war. He's not a criminal. He's not a court. Mm-hmm. He's an institution. It means you are masking the Nigerian state.
Usually, that happens only when you're going under for like a coveted operation.
Yes, you are not. This is an election that is being held every. It's a democratic process. We also had a situation whereby people in military uniforms didn't have name tag.
Exactly.
And that for us was very, very dangerous for democracy. Mm. Because if anything goes wrong, who would you hold responsible? It was an opportunity for people to commit all sorts of atrocities. Mm. And that was what they did.
Mm.
We saw a situation whereby people were abducted in their homes on the night of the election.
And they were not released until after
the election. Why hold them if you cannot bring charges against them?
Very true.
You deprive them of their constitutional right to vote. That was an infringement on the constitution of Nigeria. Because
even
the right,
on their own, on the people, on the loads of people they arrested,
yes,
they are fundamental human rights.
Yes, was deprived. Yes. Not one person was taken to court. I have pictures on my tab. People were arrested who were beaten black and blue and taken to SSL head office in Oshogbo. And after the election, at about 7 p.m. on Saturday night, they now released them.
All right, let's quickly take this call from Justin. Justin, good morning.
Good morning, Mr. Justin.
Hello, Justin. Are you there?
Yeah.
Good morning.
All right, good morning. Let's quickly take your contribution.
Yeah, my name is Justin. I'm calling from Agopala.
You're welcome.
Wow.
Please call us back.
Anyway, we really don't have.
But I understand your position. Let me take you back to what you were saying on this administration's commitment to fighting this, recovering stolen funds and all of that.
Yeah.
One thing I know for sure that may be a hindering factor is the issue of foreign policy. Some of these, can I call them thieves? I can't call them thieves, but some of these individuals who have looted
national
treasuries, some of them may have to, may run, eventually leave the country and go to some nations that, Nigeria, they do not have strong, international relationship with, making it difficult for you to exercise such extradition laws.
Yeah.
That obviously will become a huge problem.
I don't think it will be a factor because of the fact that stolen funds is a tonic for promoting terrorism.
Very true.
And the whole world has come together that terrorism must be fought.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
So the illegal transfer of funds is a serious crime in international circle. Mm-hmm. That is what that was when the Nigerian government when the Nigerian government transported 9.3 million dollars in a plane to South Africa. It was impounded. That's the government's transaction. It shows that even the local law here, the Nigerian law does not allow you to take out above $10,000 without declaring it at the point of entry.
Very true.
And when you are entering into any other country, you must declare whatever is on you.
All right, let's take our final thoughts on this. Now, what's your position? Public office holders who have been alleged to have stolen Nigerian money should be brought to book.
Definitely.
All right.
Definitely.
Our stolen funds should
be returned. Should be retrieved at all costs.
And pumped back into the Nigerian economy.
Yes, their name should be published.
Their name should be
published.
They should not be jailed.
They
should
be.
No, if the law is there.
If
found guilty, the law has already stated what should be done. It's not my own. The law was not made when I was born. The law has been
in existence.
And the law is there to ensure orderliness and peace in a society.
Now, I just want a yes or no. Don't you think the institutions that have been, that are already existing, the likes of the EFCC, seems to be stronger today?
Because they have found a new engine driver.
All right, because they found a new engine driver.
It is
on this note that we're going to say, bye-bye to Crossfire today. It's been nice talking to you, Nelson Ekunjumi. And believe you me, it's always a pleasure having you on the show. Thanks for coming.
Thank you,
Ishioma, thank you too.
All right,
we'll go now, and we'll be back tomorrow morning for another very interesting episode of Crossfire. Do come around.
Say no to violence. So, did you like what you just saw? I know you did. It's very simple. If you want to see more, just subscribe to our channel right now.